trying to get a better representation of attributes in sense that if you are taking data from elsewhere, we don't know the origin of the source. But what is happening that if you try to get a better representation in sense that what is meaning of better representation? Then simple Gaussian distribution in a standard way, we always say that that one is a better representation. So we always do what try to shift that origin to mean vector. And with respect to that origin as a reference point, we try to see the symmetricity of the distribution of attribute. So that is the better representation, simply I would like to say that in PCA. And among that, what we call that representation, latent representation also we are calling it. And in the latent representation, we try to identify which are the significant principal component, and we just keep those only significant principal component. Apart from that, other insignificant principal component, just we truncate those things. So that's where, in that process also, density reduction is happening. So we had already seen that simply one thing is that in one line difference is in PCA we are talking about a better representation of attribute, and in multivariate regression we are talking about a better representation of response. So here response we will treat as a what multivariate normal or approximate normal kind of things generally we are taking. So we will try to explain it is very much essential to recall all those properties of multivariate Gaussian distribution. So we will start with basic multivariate Gaussian distribution that happens to be in a standard form, and then we will go forward to, by doing affine transformation in order to get distribution of any kind of multivariate response vector. Always remember that here always we will have here now onward response not a single variable, it would be a vector, random vector kind of thing would come here. So coming to outline of today's lecture, first I would like to discuss about multivariate Gaussian distribution, then I will discuss about sum of squares and the quadratic form representation of sum of squares. So quadratic form representation, it is giving a very compact framework to deal any kind of that sum of square representation or mean vector and other kind of things, quantity. If you easily you can express those things in quadratic form, and if you do represent in quadratic form, what is happening that the calculation becomes very simple due to that various geometrical concept of linear algebra. So that's where we will talk in detail. These are very much essential in order to compute or in order to estimate the parameter. That's where we are coming with. So here it is very much essential to understand first what is multivariate Gaussian distribution. So we will start with the basic one, that a standard normal distribution, and after we will do affine transformation in order to get multivariate Gaussian distribution of general type or arbitrary type. Okay, so coming to first part, that multivariate Gaussian distribution, first I would like to discuss about multivariate standard Gaussian distribution, and for that we consider a p variant standard normal random vector with p number of components, or simply you can say that one is the dimension of the this standard normal distribution. There are p components. Okay, then if you talk about a standard normal random vector of dimension p, then definitely there would be a representative element as a mean vector. And what would be mean vector for a standard normal random vector? It would be simply zero vector with zero p number of zero component. Okay, and if you talk about what is the covariance structure of the standard normal random vector, so definitely covariance would be just an identity matrix, very identity matrix of what would be order p by p. So if you are having a p dimensional multivariate standard normal random vector, then we have to talk about what is the distribution. So very easy to find distribution of multivariate p dimensional standard normal distribution. How? Just what you do, you multiply all the marginal standard or PDF of marginal standard normal random vector variable, and that multiplication, that p number of multiplication, it will give PDF of or density of p variant standard normal random variable. So it is very simple, that this simplification easily you can visualize it through geometry as well. So that's why we can directly define this is the what we call it distribution or density of p variate in the normal random vector. And if you track, you see that with respect to each component of this random vector z, we are getting a density. This one is behaving like a univariate density. It is a univariate density with along the z1 axis, what we call it. This one is second univariate density. Likewise, you are multiplying how many univariate density? P number of univariate density. And in that process, we are getting density of P variate standard normal random variable. So here, this is the density. Okay. So we try to get a compact representation of this one. How we can get that compactness? We directly can get from the this representation, that dot product of Z with itself. So this representation, it look very nice. And here we just how many you can simply say that what is the simplest notation of normal random variable, that generally we denote it by n corresponding mean n corresponding variance. So here we are having p variate standard normal random vector. So that's why we here in place of a scalar mean, simply we will have a vector mean, that zero vector. That means each component of this vector happens to be zero. And what would be covariance? Here we will have covariance structure. That's why we are coming with covariance matrix. What would be that? That would be identity matrix. So this one is simplest notation. Whatever we discussed till now for multivariate standard normal distribution, we can summarize all those things here in this single notation. So this one is very meaningful and compact kind of representation. If you know about this one, then just you know everything about the standard variate normal distribution. Okay, so if you try to see geometry of bivariate standard normal random variable, then simply we can see that this shape is talking about joint distribution of any two joint distribution of two what we call it a standard normal random vector. In that process, we are getting a bivariate standard normal vector. Okay, along this one axis you can take it z1, along this one axis you can take it z2. If you do project this bivariate one along the axis, what you will observe, that you will observe univariate normal standard normal distribution. This would be univariate standard normal distribution. So vice versa relation is there, very easy to visualize this one. Now afterward, what we do, if we are having enough idea about a standard normal vector, then from there we can perform Gaussian distribution with the help of desired mean vector and desired covariance matrix in order to get a normal vector you are willing to get, you can get it from the affine transformation of a standard normal random vector. We can get it. So same criteria we are applying it here. So what affine transformation we will define it here. So first just you have to come up with what kind of mean you want, what mean vector you want, and what covariance structure you want. So with respect to that, we are defining affine structure. So we consider an affine transformation of p variate standard normal random vector z with arbitrary mean vector mu and covariance matrix sigma. Okay, that means we are having this affine transformation of z. That means we are multiplying z with a square root of covariance matrix sigma, and we translate it through mean vector mu. Okay, in that process we are getting y is a new normal vector. Simply call, you can call it normal vector or multivariate normal distribution also. Also you can say like in that perspective. So here we are having a y is a new random vector, and z we know about that. What is z is a standard normal random vector. So we know everything about z. Okay, so if you know everything about z, and this sigma we come up with our side, and mu also we come up with our side, so that's way we can easily calculate expectation of y. What would be that? It would be in term of expectation, it would be in term of simply mu. We try to find y, because if you are willing to find expectation of this linear term or linear function of z, then we know that if you try to what would be expectation of z, that one is a standard normal random vectors, so expectation of z, it would be zero vector. So if you multiply a matrix with zero vector, that would be again a zero, that zero absorb everything, that's way. So just remaining thing would be what is expectation of a constant, or whether it is a real number or vector, that expectation of a constant happens to be the number itself. So that's where we are getting that expectation of y is equal to mu. Mu happens to be now expectation of y. Now next we have to find what is the covariance matrix of y. So in order to find covariance matrix of y, we have to substitute back y in term of z. So we are doing that. So here just what it is simple covariance is again it is a very simple kind of operator, and how it quadratic nature of operator, because covariance you had already seen the in the definition of covariance, a square term is coming. So that's why covariance is a quadratic kind of operator. So if you are applying covariance transformation over this linear transformation or affine transformation of z, what will happen? This will come in quadratic term. The here sigma square root of sigma, it will come in quadratic term, and we know that what is the covariance matrix. This square, simply we are saying that this one is, it is behaving like a coefficient of z, and that means coefficient of z, it will come in quadratic form. So this is coming in quadratic term. Next, what would be covariance matrix of z? That happens to be a standard normal random vector. So what is that? In that case, covariance matrix happens to be identity matrix. So we are substituting it here and just simplify it. And if I ask what is the covariance of a scalar, single scalar, fixed constant or fixed vector, what is the covariance? Because it is a single number just given to you, and hence what will happen? So there is no variability you observe with respect to a single constant. So what does it mean? Covariance is zero. Simply it means, so covariance of mu is zero. So only covariance is contributed by this linear term. Okay. Due to that, we can say that what is the covariance matrix of y? It would be sigma. So with a given mean vector and given covariance matrix, we come up with a standard normal distribution. This y is having a standard normal distribution with mean mu and covariance sigma. So simply we can denote in that process. So what is the we can say that simply y is what it is, a normal random vector, and what is the mean is here, mean means mean vector, because y is having in various attribute, various component, and what is the covariance matrix? It is sigma. So we got the y from z. Okay. Now next we have to talk about distribution of y. What is the distribution of y? So easily we can get that Jacobian of transformation concept, that during the process of derived random variable, we had discussed enough that if you are having one random variable, then you can define function of that random variable, and the function of random variable would be again a random variable, and hence it is very much essential to get a representation of distribution of that function of random variable or derived random variable. So how we are getting it? That we are getting it through Jacobian of transformation. Then same concept we are applying here, that first we are going to take distribution of original thing. So what is the original given thing here? It is a standard normal random vector we are given here. So we know that we have to take distribution of z, and we have to multiply with Jacobian factor. This one is coming with respect to Jacobian factor, and I had already mentioned that why we are taking positive sign, in order to keep positivity of density always happens to be greater than or equal to zero. That's for the sake of positivity we are putting this modulus term. Okay. And if you simplify, then we are getting a representation of density of y in the form of how it is taking like this form, 1 by a square root of 2 pi to the power p times we are taking a square root of this. What is this one? This one is determinant of the covariance matrix. a square root of the determinant of covariance matrix. So this simply we are calling it a scalar part or coefficient part, what we are, or normalizing constant also you can call it. Better name is normalizing constant. Now we are coming to distribution part. So this one again we see that in distribution part, this argument of exponential, it is containing an argument what quadratic form, and quadratic form is defined in term of in term of mu and sigma. It is coming in a very systematic form. So now onward, just recall this quadratic form a lot from linear algebra. We had already discussed a lot about quadratic form. So this quadratic form, if you talk about quadratic form, so it is a function of several variables, but the value, real valued function of several variables. So it is a scalar, because we just do quadratic form with respect to inverse of sigma, that happens to be covariance matrix of y. So easily we can say that we are having y, that we got it by a fine transformation of z carried out through scaling. It is happening through a square root of covariance matrix or sigma. Simply right now call it a square root of sigma, and we do after that translation, and that one is happening with respect to a given mean vector. So finally we got y having this detail. All these are detail we are having. Everything. So we got this normal random vector. Easily we got it. Okay. So we can talk about variability of density from the perspective of covariance matrix. So how we can see that? So we see that determinant of covariance, that one is just in the denominator. So that's way the density will decrease as we move towards mean vector of y. Okay, it would be here mu. So it will decrease when we move towards mean. So that's way we are trying to decrease the value of determinant of corresponding covariance matrix. It simply indicates that y's are very much near to mu, concentrated near to mu, in a very small neighborhood of mu, what we would like to say that. Okay. So a small value of mu, it what does it signify? It signify that there is a high degree of multicollinearity among the variables. Okay, so high multicollinearity indicates that the variables are highly intercorrelated. Okay, in which case the it tend to occupy a subspace of p-dimensional. That one is highly correlated. In which we observe that y is highly correlated. So again, someone is willing to get a better representation that if you try to visualize orthogonality, that if you don't want intercorrelation, so what you do, you just apply PCA there within response vector as well. There is no issue, you can get. But we don't have to do all that. PCA generally we apply to attribute only in order to get a better representation. But why? Because those are provided to us. That's why we try to get a better representation for computational perspective. So here one more approach is coming in order to discuss further about a standard normal random vector. That one is moment generating function. So we can define moment generating function for any random vector, or generally here in Gaussian, I will talk from the Gaussian perspective how we define moment generating function for normal random vector. So we can define it again. It is coming with respect to one quadratic representation of the what we call it covariance matrix. So here it is defined like this way. You can easily see that. And you have to proceed with most of moment generating function defined in term of exponential. Exponential, so it is defined like this way. And from here we can easily get moment generating function for a standard normal random vector. We can get it. So this is the case. So here in moment generating function, we observe two important kind of probability or two important kind of what situation, what are those? So one situation it says that if two random vector have the same moment genetic function, then simply we can claim that both will have the same density. So one is here, the approach is moment genetic function approach. Another approach that you can discuss about distribution function or cumulative distribution function, that I had already discussed that what is cumulative distribution function. That one is talking about unification of any kind of distribution. So whether that random variable might be continuous, might be discrete, might be mixed. So there are various situations for those kind of random variable. So if you try to get a unified theory, so always we try to define cumulative distribution function. That one is giving unified theory. Similar perspective is coming also in the case of moment genetic function. So whatever I am discussing here, if you are very much interested further, then you can try to derive all these results from the perspective of cumulative distribution function as well. So same thing we had already done for discrete and continuous as well. So you can just borrow those ideas here as well. So now what is the second situation what we are interesting thing what we are getting here? Two random vector, we will say that it would be independent if and only if the joint moment genetic function that we are getting it, that simply factor into two separate component, the product of two component, two moment genetic function, then simply we can claim that those two would be independent random vector. Same thing we had already discussed also with from the cumulative distribution function as well. So if there is a clear separation, that if you are trying to express joint CDF cumulative distribution function as a product of individual one or marginal one, then simply we can claim that those two would be independent to each other. But it is not always to put in that framework. You need to do little bit competition. So now once we are having a multiple normal random vector, then we can talk about further affine transformation of that. So till now what we discussed, so we discussed that if you are having a standard normal random variable, we do perform a very special kind of affine transformation using a non-covariance matrix sigma. So how we perform affine transformation of Z, we multiply this square root of sigma with Z, that standard normal random vector, and after that we do shifting. So in that process we are getting a general kind of or arbitrary kind of normal random vector. So this one, okay. Now once we are having, further we can talk about affine transformation of Y. So with respect to any given arbitrary matrix, or generally that, but only one condition over that matrix would be that symmetry. Because if we are putting symmetric nature, then there would be some computational easiness. Okay, so consider we are having a p-dimensional random vector Y with mean vector mu and covariance matrix sigma. So we take any constant, okay, matrix A. We are taking any constant matrix A and a constant number A. Okay, this A is any constant number, and A, B, and any constant matrix, and we are putting a condition that rank of that matrix may be up to P, the dimension of Y. Okay, P is the dimension of Y. So with respect to that, we are performing a linear transformation of Y from the given vector A. So we denote it by, again, we can take a better notation, X. X would be a better notation. Z, we have already fixed it for a standard normal random vector. So here we will take any other notation here than Z, X. So X is A transpose Y. Simply we are taking dot product of A with Y. Dimension of A and Y both would be same. Okay, so we can say that it is what is this one? So here Y was what? It was a random vector. So if it is a random vector, then what is happening? It is having a mean as a vector, mu as a mean vector, and matrix sigma, that one is a covariance matrix. So if you do a scalar multiplication of Y with a given fixed vector A, then in that In that process, what we are getting? We are getting a scalar. This A transpose Y, this one is a scalar. So if we are getting a scalar representation of Y, then what does it mean? Representation, I am saying from rigid representation perspective, it is very much a time I have already discussed that. What does it talk about? So what does it talk about? It is now a scalar. So it is it will have univariate normal distribution. And then if it is having univariate normal distribution, then what is the mean? Mean would be A transpose mu. And what would be the covariance? Or there would be no covariance, simply covariance will be converted into variance. So what would be variance? Variance would be A transpose sigma A, this quadratic form of sigma in the direction of A. Simply we can say that in the direction of A. So very simple representation. This one is having very simple geometry and representation. Okay, now this one is what? With respect to linear transformation, we can do perform affine as well. So what we do? First we perform linear transformation, after that we do translation. So through that we are getting an affine transformation. Okay, so suppose X is the affine transformation of Y with A and B. So we can say that what would be the here in this case X is now it is a vector, it is Y because it is coming matrix vector product. So that's why X would be a vector. So it would have a that means simply we can say that X is a random vector of the same dimension what Y is having. So Y is known to us, we know the distribution of Y. So from there we can derive the distribution of X, or X simply you can say that it is a linear derived distribution of X is having a linear derived distribution with respect to Y, that we are getting it with from Y. That's why we are saying that. And what is the mean vector of X? It just we are getting with respect to with the what same affine transformation we are getting mean vector of X. And also we need to find covariance matrix. What is the covariance matrix? Just do take quadratic kind of product with sigma. So quadratic product we are taking in this way, A times sigma times A transpose. So this one is giving what? It is giving covariance matrix of X. So we got it through affine transformation of Y in the form of X. So various transformations you can perform. Suppose further, if we try to see only meaningful component in the random vector, definitely there would be P component. Among the P component, we try to find, we just suppose at a time we did try to deal with R number of component only. So in that process we are getting R dimensional random vector, R dimensional random vector we are getting from P dimensional random vector. So that's why it would be just a sub vector. Suppose you can go through sorting, consider first R, or you can consider last R, depends upon what you are willing to proceed with. Okay, so simply in that process we are getting R vector. So there are various composition you can do here. So if you talk about if you are having R random vector, a dimensional random vector, then obvious question would be again what would be mean vector and what would be covariance matrix. So it would be simply borrowed from the original p dimensional structure. Directly it will borrow from there, easily you can get it. Okay, so here we come up with that is simply a decomposition of a higher dimensional random vector into lower dimensional. Just it depends upon we try to get a joint representation of response and attribute together. So in that perspective this decomposition is helping a lot. Suppose V, it is a random vector having decomposed into two random vector. First one is Y and second one is X. Okay, and V is having a covariance structure sigma and mean vector mu. Okay, so that thing is fine. Okay, now we are apart from that we are putting one assumption is that Y and X both happens to be independent to each other. So okay, and having Gaussian distribution. So if we are putting that condition, what does it signify? That means if you try to find covariance correlation between those two random vector X and Y, then covariance would be zero, because those are uncorrelated. That means how you measure that uncorrelation in the perspective of independent nature, that correlation happens to be zero, and hence covariance would be zero between y and x. So that's why we are taking this component. So we are getting, in this case, we are putting, if y and x happens to be independent to each other, that means the covariance between those two are zero, then simply we can get a diagonal structure of the corresponding covariance matrix of V. That happens to be this diagonal, the first diagonal, it is not a entry, it is simply a matrix. It depends upon again. So this covariance structure, it is directly coming from p dimensional component y, and second, this covariance structure, it is coming from q dimensional component x. So overall, if you talk about what is the dimension of this covariance matrix, it is dimension of this one is p plus q into p plus q. Okay, in which we are getting a very special representation of covariance matrix of this vector v, that in this diagonal framework, in which this 0 is talking about 0 matrix, this one is talking about covariance matrix of y, this one is talking about 0 matrix, and this one is talking about covariance matrix of x. So that representation we are getting. And this looks very simple representation from the computational perspective. Okay, so we got the what representation of covariance structure of V, where V has been decomposed into two independent random vector y and x. So here I will take, so for all those things what we discussed, I try to summarize all those things through one example, very simple kind of three dimensional random vector. We will try to do all those theoretical things here. So what kind of structure we will see it here. So if one more property is there, that if x and y happens to be jointly multivariate normal and uncorrelated, those are uncorrelated, that means covariance is non-zero, then the in that case we can define conditional distribution of y given x, and generally it is what it is, your hypothesis function happens to be conditional expectation kind of thing, that through this function we try to approximate y. So if we talk about here, that generally it is having a multivariate normal distribution, then if it is having a multivariate normal distribution, then question would be, what is the mean vector and what is the covariance matrix? So mean vector, it is very simple, that what you do, you are having a mean vector of y given x. Y you can treat as a response and x is attribute. So just for regression purpose, that multivariate regression is already started here. So question would be that, what is the mean, or what is the linear function or linear model for this one? So that's why we are defining like this way. So here the first component, this one is coming directly as a mean of y, and this component is coming due to relation between x and y, because y, it would be definitely a function of x. So from there we are getting this representation. Okay, or further, if you are willing to find what is the covariance of this conditional random variable y given x, so we can get it again. This component is directly coming from y, because this one is y given x, it is a conditional dependency, it is talking about conditional dependency of y over x. So that's way we will get the covariance of y, and what information, those the relation, due to the relation between y and x, we will get this component. So that's why we have to subtract it out to, from y. So we are just trying to look for very smaller region that in which we observe y is having dependency over x, and hence we will have a covariance structure of y given x. Okay, so one example here, as I mentioned, that I would like to take one example. This one is very simple example. We are taking y as a three-dimensional random vector, and that one is having a mean vector, that 3, 1, 2, and covariance matrix, this symmetric covariance matrix. First row is 4, 0, 2, second row is 0, 1, minus 1, third row is 2, minus 1, 3. So we are having all the known information. So from there, what we do, we try to get a linear transformation of y. How we are getting it? So we are taking a constant vector 1, minus 2, 1, and we do take a dot product of this constant vector with y. In that process, we are getting a scalar representation of mean. What is meaning of that? That means we are projecting mean in the direction of a. So simply that projection it is talking. That's why if your direction is fixed, it then we just move in the particular direction. That means we are having a univariate movement. So if there is a univariate movement, then what does it mean? It will have a univariate distribution. So that's why we are having a univariate mean due to transformation of the data in the direction of A. And what is the mean in that direction? Mean would be 3 as a projection of mu in the direction of A. That means dot product of A with mu, and just do a dot product simply, we will get 3. And we need to get variance of all the data, those has been all three dimensional data, those has been projected in the direction of A. So how we can get it? We can get it through this quartic form. So that means A transpose sigma A, and A is given to us, sigma is also given to us. So do compute this one, and we are getting 19. So 19 is the variance of projected data in the direction of A. Okay. So this one is what we did projection of all the three dimensional vector in the direction of A. Now next we will do projection of the three dimensional data along a plane, on the plane. So if you talk about plane, then plane is having two direction. Always it will have its two directions. It will have two directions. That's why one direction we are saying it is coming from the matrix, first row of the matrix. A second direction is coming from second row of the matrix. So these two directions. So that's why simply we are projecting all three dimensional data into two dimensional plane. So in that perspective, we are getting this transformation that we denote it by W. So Y has been transformed by a matrix of order 2/3. Okay, any question till now? Any question? No. It looks like that you all are very good odd listener, but unable to respond. Okay, so here I told that this one is talking about one dimensional projection of all the three dimensional random vector, and second one is talking about two dimensional projection of all the three dimensional random vector. So definitely this problem would be much more complicated. So if you are not responding, then I am giving one homework. What is that? So you have to find here mean vector of this transformation W. So find the mean vector. What is the W? Is just we are getting projecting all the Y in plane generated by these two rows. Okay, so find the mean vector. That means what is mean here? Mean of W, and also find the covariance structure of W. Find the covariance structure both. So it is a homework. You have to find all these. What is the covariance structure of W? In numeric form, not like this way. So here easily we can say that here it would be two dimensional, mean vector would be two dimensional, and covariance of W it would be again 2/2 matrix. Because why we are doing? Because we are projecting all the dimensional data in the plane. In plane, what we are having two directions, so that's why two dimensional still we will get it here. Okay, next we are going to discuss about sum of a square and compact representation of sum of a square with respect to quartic form. So quartic form always we define with respect to a symmetric matrix. If matrix is not symmetric, then there is no issue. We can always decompose that in quartic form after a little bit manipulation. So take a simple matrix A, and after that we do perform X transpose A, and after that we again do perform multiplication of X transpose A with X. So what is this one? This one is the quartic representation of A, the matrix A. Always we say like this way. So in short, we call it quartic form. So we are talking about sum of a squares and quartic form, because we at hand we will have sample. So that sample will have a particular size. So that's why it is very much essential to define sum of a squares. So a sum of a square encounters its regression as a quartic form, where Y happens to be a random vector and A happens to be a symmetric matrix. There is no issue. If it is not symmetric, we can always decompose in symmetric. There is a process for that. So certain sum of a squares will come up with certain sum of a square. And if you talk about what is the distribution of sum of a square, then it would be chi square distribution, and each one would be independent of other one. Okay, other sum of a square. So independently we will observe here, and chi square distribution is really interesting. Generally generated from it is talking about distribution of error, a square error. That's very much interesting. So just we are taking a sample of size n. So you can remember that. We are having an observation with n number of components. So simply you can say that we are having a sample of size n, be a random sample. We have taken it from the population, and that population is having mean mu and variance sigma square. Okay, so if you are taking that, then first what we have to do, we have to easily define simple kind of estimate of mu. What would be that? Because mu is unknown to us, sigma is also unknown to us, so we have to take estimate of mean mu. How we do estimate that? We do it through sample mean. So sample, we are defining here sample mean. That means simple empirical average, what from the sample, given sample, what we are getting it. So here, once we are having this sample mean, then we will stop there, and we will try to express all the sum of a squares in term of quadratic form, in term of mu, and this sample mean, other things will come. Okay, so just we are taking sum of a square. What is that? That means we are squaring each y and summing it up. I varies from 1 to n. N is the sample size. Okay, so we do little bit here. What we do, we adding and subtracting these two terms in order to get this representation. Okay, and here what we do, if you try to observe it, it is getting here sum of a square term is getting a representation of this quadratic form y transpose x. What is this one? If you try to see it, then you have taken dot product y with itself. So that's way in this dot product, generally also we denote it in the form of this projection representation. Okay, now we try to get representation of sample mean also in term of vector form or in term of what we call it dot product. So sample, if you try to look into here this in this picture, so y I is this simply sum of y I, you can talk about it would be actually dot product of one vector. What is one vector? That means a vector which is having every component one. So here y1 plus y2 plus up to yn, what is that? That one is just a dot product of one vector with y itself. So here, and after that we divide it by number of that sample size, simply we divide it by, so that one is n. So we can say that the sample mean is what? It is this dot product of one vector with y, after that we divide it by n. So again we are getting a compact representation of y in term of dot product. Okay, now again we can get representation of various other things, that like we can get a square representation of this n time a square of sample mean. Okay, so we are getting, this is the representation. After simplification we will simply see that what is happening, that if someone is asking then here in next here we will see representation. Here this n times a square of sample mean, it is getting a representation, again a quadratic representation. What is that? Y transpose 1 by n z y j. Okay, j is what? Just I'm changing the notation here. What is j? J I is mean for identity matrix, everyone know that. Here along diagonal we observe non-zero entry, that happens to be 1, and all non off diagonal element happens to be 0. That's why this is identity matrix. Okay, this is identity matrix. What is J? J is a matrix whose each component is 1. J is another kind of matrix, that's very simple to remember. That simply you can say that J is coming as a outer product of one vector. So we know that if you take a vector and if you do outer product of that vector with itself, then in that process we are getting one rank matrix. one rank matrix. So that's where here j is the outer product of one vector with itself. Okay, so that's why it is a n by n matrix. And here we are here with respect to this matrix, we are defining a quadratic form, and that quadratic form is actually a compact representation of n times square of sample mean. Now, using this representation, all these representations, we can get a very simple or compact kind of representation of a square of mean deviation of all member of the sample. All member of the sample. So here mean deviation, we are not performing deviation from the actual mean of the population. We are performing deviation from the sample mean, what we had already calculated from the sample. Okay. Or through empirical average. So if you try to simplify it further, we see that again this square term, sum of a square term, can be written as a what quadratic form, y transpose 1 minus y transpose identity matrix minus 1 by n times j. J is what, again I told that it is outer product of one vector times y. So this quadratic, again we are getting a quadratic representation of this sum. Any question? No. Okay, it is already above 45 minutes. So if you are having any question, you can ask. Otherwise, I am going to wind up today's lecture. And in next lecture, we will discuss multivariate regression in detail. And I would like to say that it is revision of multivariate normal distribution. So again, try to revise it. If you are very good in this part, definitely it will help to understand multivariate regression. So just keep on revising this one, this lecture.